You know, one of the disadvantages of living in a small town in the winter is you never drive far enough for your car heater to warm up. Almost makes me wish they'd move the beer store to Port Asbestos. Luckily, the handyman always has a solution. Rather than wasting a whole bunch of gas warming up your car heater, I got a better idea. Or at least I should say, a cheaper idea. I've lined a hole inside of my coat with toaster elements. And then I hook them up to this plug and it goes right into the cigarette lighter. So in about 10 seconds, I'll be warm as toast. You could line the inside of your pants the same way, but instead of a toaster, you should use a bun warmer. I recommend you give this a try. I guarantee you'll be the toast of the town. Pleasant surprise, and that doesn't happen all that often when you're a middle-aged man in a world riddled with full-length mirrors. You know, when Harold took on the job as public relations director for the Possum Lake area, I was afraid he was going to wreck the lodge just so people would like it. But here we are almost a year later, and he really hasn't changed anything. I mean, that suits me fine. I find life goes better when people don't do anything.
Uncle Red, I have something I have to discuss with you.
Yeah, no, okay, that's fine. You know what? I was just telling everybody how proud I am of how little you've accomplished.
Huh. Yeah, yeah. I appreciate that.
All right, good, yeah.
Of course, City Council has a bit of a different take on it.
Oh.
Overall, my department is showing a net loss of $5,000.
Oh, man, that's not bad, huh?
Well, they were hoping for a profit.
Oh.
You know,
they hired me as a revenue source, so they're pretty disappointed.
Well, Harold, you know, life is about disappointment. You'd know that if you were married.
Well, now my contract's up for renewal. Right. I have to find a way to cover off the $5,000 shortfall. Oh, so I booked an appointment with the bank manager.
Well, there you go. And don't take any guff from him, Harold. I mean, you know, he's there to lend money. I mean, that's his job, okay? And there's other banks. Like, if he doesn't offer you something that you like, you just give him the big orange and hike it on out of there.
Okay, yeah. Okay, okay, good,
yeah.
Good,
yeah.
Good, because I need you to go with me.
Oh, no, Harold, no, that guy scares the crap out of me.
Come on, I'll do all the talking. You know, and the lodge is a big part of the problem.
Oh.
Yeah, so I need you to wear this sports coat, you know, because it makes a better and professional impression.
Okay, I thought you were just taking this to the cleaners.
No, all set, come on, let's go.
No, you want me to take it to the cleaners when I'm done?
No, why are you so concerned about my jacket?
Well, every time I've been to the bank, somebody ends up going to the cleaners.
It's time for the Possum Lodge Word Game! Today's prize is a ride-along in a police cruiser with one of Possum Lake's finest. Experience the thrills, the high-speed chases, the drive-bys, and the drive-throughs. This is a great prize. I've been in a couple of these myself. Okay, cover your thingies. Okay, Mr. Green, you've got 30 seconds to get Winston to say this word. Denial. Denial. And go.
Okay, Winston, this is the opposite of admission.
Subtraction?
Okay. Someone who's unaware of their own weaknesses or shortcomings is obviously in...
politics.
Okay. If somebody is out of touch with reality, they're experiencing...
a beer buzz.
Almost out of time, Mr. Green.
Yeah. Oh, I know. Winston, what was that slogan you came up... Remember last week you came up with a slogan?
Yeah.
I love sucking septics. Yeah. It suits my style. I'd rather be in sewage than live in denial.
There we go, baby! This is the repair shop part of the show we call If It Ain't Broke, You're Not Trying. Joining me today, Dalton Humphrey of Humphrey's Everything Store. You got any bargains down in the store there, Dalton?
You betcha, Red. You drop by before noon on Saturday. The admission is free.
You normally charge admission to your store?
Well, it's not just a store, Ed. I kind of think of it as a thrift museum.
And is this an artifact from the cheap crap display?
No. That's my wife's waffle iron. I was wondering if you could help me clean it.
You make waffles out of petroleum products? Some kind of melted rubber on here.
Yeah, right. Well, you know, I wore all the treads off my work boots, and so I saw that the pattern on this waffle iron was the same, so I figured I could, you know, I'd just...
Start liquefying some noxious materials in your kitchen to save a few bucks, huh?
Boy, I never thought of it that way. Yeah. Gee, I thought maybe the budgie just died of old age.
Well, I can... might be able to get that off with a screwdriver, so... How did you wear the treads off your work boots, anyway?
Well, I finally decided to build that gazebo my wife's been asking for, so I had to pick up about a ton of lumber and shingles and stuff, so I just threw it all in the back of my truck, see?
Well, that old pickup truck? Finally coughed up enough money to get the brakes fixed on that unit?
No, that's how I wore the treads off my shoes. Yeah. So can you help me clean this up?
Yeah, I think she's pretty good right there, Dalton.
Huh? Well, that's great. I do. I wish I could pay you.
Well, why don't you just give me the waffle iron, huh?
No. I need this. No, I'm gonna make some snow tires.
People sometimes call me a chump. They say I'm too small to handle a dump, but I can suck up any size lump. It's not the length of the hose, it's the strength of the pump.
Don't you hate driving in winter when your tires just sit there and spin? Oh, sure, it's okay if you're just driving to school or to work or something. But other than that, it can be a real pain. So this time on Handyman Corner, I'm going to show you how you can convert your car into a go-anywhere winter vehicle. First thing we got to do is increase the traction on the back wheels. And to do that, you're going to need a man's belt made out of leather and big enough to go all the way around the tire. If you're a math whiz now, what you do is measure the diameter and multiply that by pi. Or you could just get yourself a couple of Moose Thompson's belts. They're used to being around a tire, and I'm sure pi was involved. But before we mount the belts onto the wheels, we need to add something to them to give us a lot more traction. I suggest cutlery. You probably will have a bunch of old, used cutlery around your house. We're not that lucky at the lodge. We have lots of old cutlery, but hardly any of it is used. Now, you notice I attached all the cutlery on there using the handyman's secret weapon, duct tape. Now, all I have to do is replace the standard wheels with these babies, and I'm good to go. Yeah, it's just that easy. Now you'll be able to go anywhere, even if there's a fork in the road. Get it? Oh, take a look at this. To make sure the front wheels glide along smoothly, I found a great use for those old toboggans. So remember, if the women don't find you handsome, they should at least find you handy. Crazy stuff happening on the roads these days. I mean, you see the ads on TV where they got some yuppie weenie in a high-priced status mobile sliding into a corner in a four-wheel drift going about 130. You think to yourself, now who would be stupid enough to try that? You go out in the highway, there's your answer. I mean, these guys, they're dipsy-doodling through the traffic doing twice the speed of sense, turning your relaxing drive into a teeth grinder. You know, what these goofs are saying more or less is, hey, out of the way, sucker, make room for the big fish, huh? Now, I know the normal reaction is to teach them a lesson by driving like an idiot yourself. But you might want to think that one over. You know, at that speed, the road will be going by pretty fast when you look down through the floorboards of your K-car. So instead, I say just slow down, think about the truth. That guy that just blew past you is trying to make payments on a $60,000 car. And he's got to get to work early so he can get a promotion so that next year he can make payments on an $80,000 car. I mean, it's like he's treading water in a saucepan. He's not going to drown, but he's still cooked. Whereas you, my friend, have the sweet life. If you're late for work, nobody cares. You don't have to risk your life. You see a promotion coming your way? No chance. So you just sit back, turn off the radio if it still works. Don't let the big fish in the small car bother you. Right now, he's just the one who got away. But in the long run, you're the one who got your way. Remember, I'm pulling for you. We're all in this together.
If your home has started to smell like a barn, and you're 1,000 miles from the nearest farm, call before the stink does any more harm. Don't wait till it sets off the smoke alarm.
What a beautiful day.
Yeah, you won't see another one like it today, Dalton.
Almost like a dream, except for the smell of the lake.
Maybe it is a dream.
Say, what is that smell anyway?
Well, it's either raw sewage or dead algae or Dalton.
You know, it could be a dream. Maybe I'm dreaming and you two aren't real.
Or maybe I'm dreaming. This could be my dream. Except you guys would be wearing dresses.
Well, if it was my dream, I'd have caught some fish by now. And I wouldn't have you two. I'd have Harpo Marx and Marcel Marceau here.
I think he wants us to be quiet.
I sense that.
What do you dream about, Mr. Green?
A perfect world, Mike, where nobody bothers me.
Amen.
Yep.
But for nobody to bother you, you'd have to be alone.
Well, sometimes a man needs to be alone, Mike.
I know. It's called solitary. I just never heard of anybody dreaming about it before.
Well, no, we don't want to be alone all the time. Just some of the time, that's all.
A lot of the time. No. Most of the time.
Not me. I like to be with people, interacting, sharing.
You know, Mike, when you steal a person's watch, that's not called sharing.
That's been a harsh lesson for me.
Okay, so we go down to the bank to borrow the $5,000, and I was asked to be there, you know, and I was told to sit quietly and keep my mouth shut. That's what you told me, isn't it, Harold?
Everyone in the bank told you.
Okay, that's fine. So I'm sitting there waiting for Harold Trump here to ask for the $5,000.
You can't just borrow money. You have to have a business plan.
No, you don't. I've never had a business plan.
You never had a business.
Well, this is a lodge, Harold. This is for the enjoyment of people like me. It's not about making money.
And it's my job to change that. I like my job. I don't want to lose it and have to move away again. That's why I made the proposal.
Oh, boy, you should have heard this. What he says to the guy is, we want to make all kinds of improvements to the lodge so it'll attract tourists to come up from the city. Who wants that?
Well, we have a financial problem, Uncle Red.
Well, okay, yeah, we have a $5,000 problem, Harold. Why can't we just borrow against the lodge? It's got to be worth at least $5,000.
Well, I'd say closer to $200,000.
Really? $200,000?
No.
$200?
That's the one. Yeah.
What are you talking about, Harold? I mean, the land alone's got to be worth at least $50,000.
You don't own the land. The bank does.
Well, then what are they worried about?
That doesn't even make sense.
No, it's
not. Uncle Red, the only way out of this is that we have to make major renovations, and then the lodge can become a profit center.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you should have heard this one. He hits the bank up for $2 million. I mean, it was the most insane thing I ever heard in my life, but then the bank manager tops him by saying yes.
Well, you know, it's a good investment when he sees one.
Harold, that's not a good investment. That's insanity. You don't take on a $2 million debt to solve a $5,000 problem.
It's the way the government does it.
Mike and I had kind of agreed to meet out by the woods there and just go and have a little picnic, just the two of us. Sometimes when Mike pulled up on a car, I went, wow, boy, there's a... That is a nice set of wheels. That your car, Mike? Oh, yeah. It's his car, all right. Well, it's his car now, I guess. And I got a little suspicious when he couldn't figure out, you know, how to open the trunk. And so I said, look, you know, this is one of these fancy, it's a remote deal. You push the button and it opens the trunk. So you just go like that. And funny, he didn't know that, eh, with it being his car and everything. And so he had brought his stuff for the picnic, which was, I think, about 10 of those boxes of canned stew. I figured one would do it, but he wanted to take them all. He said he needed to hide them for a while. So as long as I wasn't carrying them, I didn't mind. And he also had brought a two-wheel dolly that It had a bit of a fresh look to it as well, but I didn't ask any questions. So away we go into the woods. It's a great day, fantastic day. Wow, it's a beautiful, beautiful day. And we got in there, and I got to give my credit, you know. Things get tough, but he doesn't quit, you know. He finds a way to get the job done one way or another. So we got the fire going. I was making a hot dog, but Mike had nothing open. He didn't have a can opener. I forgot the can. I didn't have a can opener on me. So I said, well, maybe you should just go back to the car. And so he's going to go back to the car. And I thought, you know, if you're going to go back to the car, you might as well go in the direction where the car is. Could probably speed things up somewhat, you know. And something happened here. I know, you know, sometimes you get into the woods, and if there's not a clear trail, you end up doing a U-turn. You don't even, and that, you know, it's the kind of thing that can happen to anybody, but I don't know how he ended up coming in the wrong way on that. But so I said, Mike, you go back that way, and then I'll go the way you were supposed to go, and I'm sure it's gonna work out fine. So I come down through the woods, and like I say, it can happen to anybody. And next thing you know, I come back. I don't know if I'm ever gonna see Mike again, but, oh yeah, there he is eating my hot dog. So I figure, okay, we need to add some technology into this mystery. So I'm asking him for his little remote thing there, and I'm figuring if I can honk the car horn. And when you walk him, the horn honks on these. So we listen for it. Yeah. And now we just got to figure out which way. I see. Go walk the way it's coming. No. Okay, that's not going to work. All right. Okay, plan B. It's also got the remote starter on the back of that. So if we start her up, and if she's in gear at all, she should start driving towards us. And that would be a... We just look at the car. Should come. Oh, I didn't see the tree there. Okay, that was it. Okay, there's going to be some damage on your new car. Oh, there's going to be some damage. I don't know what we do now. Wait a sec. If the car hit the tree and we're at one end of the tree, it means that, well, this is a brilliant way to find your way home. So all you kids out there, just follow the tree that your house knocked over and you'll get back to where. Anyway, it doesn't matter about that. It was a great day, and Mike's car, I'm sure, will be covered by somebody's insurance.
When your septics need cleaning because they smell unkempt, it happens to everyone. No one's exempt. Call your friends at Rothschild. We hold no contempt. We'll suck out your sewage or die in the attempt.
Now, to me, the mark of a true handyman is to be able to see what something does and then use it in a completely different application. For example, they have this bubbly medicine for stomach aches or headaches or dry heaves or whatever. See that? Goes nuts when it hits the water. Kind of like a 3-year-old at a wading pool. That's power you're looking at there. And I'm thinking, there's got to be a better way of using that power. How about making a power canoe? Just attach a piece of drain pipe to the side, running from above the gunnels down into the water. Make sure you attach it loose so you got forward and reverse. Now you just pour the medicine down the pipe, it hits the water coming up, and that starts making the power. Now all you have to do is direct that power so it comes out the bottom of the pipe. That's what this cork is for. All right, let's give her a go. We're just gonna pour the medicine into the hole, then jam the cork in there and hang on to the pipe. Oh yeah, one more thing. Go big or go home. Well, I think I got the financial problem solved. See, all we really need is $5,000. Now, okay, none of the Possum Lodge members have that kind of cash, but I'm figuring, hey, why don't we pool our money? Or maybe a better way to say it is, why don't we puddle our money? So I figure, okay, if I get 5 guys to put up 1,000 each, but that's too high, and then I think, okay, 50,000 guys at a dime each, that's gonna take forever, and I think, okay, 50 guys at $100 a piece, and that works out to, well, close enough. So I got her knocked, right? Yeah.
Uncle Red, you wanted to see me?
Absolutely, Harold, I got great news. I've solved the problem. Here's a check right there for $5,000. Huh?
Wow! I can't accept this.
Oh, no, you can accept it, Harold. It's a loan, okay? And take your time paying it back. That's what we do.
No, it's not a large debt. This is a personal problem. It's important to me that I find a solution.
No, I know, Harold, we don't like the solution, okay? We don't want the lodge to change, Harold, okay? Everything in life changes. We need the lodge to stay exactly the way it is.
I understand that.
You understand it? Well, you borrowed $2 million to turn it into the Mosquito Hilton.
No, 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 canceled that loan.
Great. Oh, well, then you use the check so you can keep your job. Huh? All right.
You know, in your own way, you're saying that you like me and that you want me to stay.
I said that?
Yes, and this check means nothing. That means way more to me.
I said that?
You know what I did? So you know what I did? I'll tell you what I did. What I did was I paid the $5,000 out of my own pocket. So yes, I am staying.
Well, good for you, Harold. You know what? Good for all of us, eh?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I'd rather like a lower income if it means I'm being able to live here.
Good for you.
Is that dumb?
I don't know, but it's how Canada was built.
Meeting time.
Yeah, you go ahead, Harold, okay? I'll be right down. Oh, this is great. Okay, if my wife is watching, boy, oh boy. Harold has abandoned his whole plan to renovate the lodge. That's gotta be great news. And he actually paid off a debt, and that's about as much radical change as we can absorb at one time. And to the rest of you, thanks for watching. On behalf of myself and Harold and the whole gang up here at Possum Lodge, you keep your stick on the ice, huh?
Have a seat. Sit down. All right.
Quando, Omni, Flunkus, Moritati.
Sit down. All right, bow your heads for the men's prayer.
I'm a man that I can change if I have to, I guess.
Okay, man, I got great news. Harold has actually paid off the debt all by himself, huh? So now we don't have to worry about the bank honoring this check, even though we post-dated it 10 years from now.